My name is Brittany, and I'm a digital artist with a minor in biology, and frankly, I'm sick of science being taught from a textbook. My science videos are made specifically for people that are visual and tactile learners. It's annoying that we're in a digital age where education could be way more interesting, but we're stuck with books and text. So without further ado, let's jump into simple Mendelian genetics. This video is split into four sections: definitions, visual explanation, connect to classic instruction, and examples. If you are watching this video, you're clearly taking charge of your own education, so I'm trying not to waste your time. If there's sections you want to skip, I've made it simple to do so by using the colored borders. We're going to start with the definitions displayed here. However, if you feel you already understand them, feel free to skip ahead to the green section. Definitions. The first group of terms we need to understand before starting with genetics are genes, alleles, and loci. Loci is the location of a gene on a chromosome. Gene is a segment of DNA that codes for a trait, and an allele is a specific form of a gene. Okay, but what does that mean? Think of it like a filing cabinet. Your DNA is holding tons and tons of information, and it all needs to be super organized. The loci is where the file is stored. It's always in the exact same place for members of the same species. You can imagine the gene as a folder. It's a specific chunk of DNA that holds the information for a trait. Every human has the same genes. There's a file for eye color, hair color, freckles, and more. So, why don't we look all identical if we have the same genes? Well, this is where alleles come into play. The alleles are information inside the folders. Let's compare these two people's complexion. If we look at their loci, genes, and alleles. The loci, or location of the complexion gene, is in the same place. Both of them have a complexion gene. However, the only difference is the allele information. This allele is coding for freckles, whereas this one is coding for no freckles. Hopefully that makes sense. I feel like this is the most confusing part to people first learning about genetics. Knowing the terminology is so important because it's usually the wording that will get you tripped up on tests. If you check the link in the description of this video, I've created a glossary for this lesson, and so if you want to, you can print it out and study with it. Okay, so moving on to our next terms, homozygous and heterozygous. As you might know from learning about human development, you get 50% of your DNA from your biological mother and 50% of your DNA from your biological father. This means for every gene, you actually have two copies. Homozygous and heterozygous simply compare these alleles. If an individual has two of the same alleles, it's homozygous, whereas if the alleles are different, it is heterozygous. This is simple to remember if you think of the root of the word. Homo means same, whereas hetero means different. In terms of genes, this would be an example of a homozygous individual, while this is a heterozygous individual. Really quickly, let's go through a few examples. Is this homozygous or heterozygous? Heterozygous. Now what about this? Yes, heterozygous again. And this? Homozygous. Great. I'm gonna assume you got those right because obviously I can't see you. Okay, let's add it to the glossary. Okay, next. Genotype and phenotype. These terms are really simple. Genotype refers to the genetic makeup of the individual, and phenotype refers to the observable characteristics. Simply put, genotype is the genes, phenotype is what you can see. These two terms are fairly straightforward, but often people will get confused on tests with the wording, so make sure you understand it. Okay. The last term we need to know for simple Mendelian genetics is the law of segregation. The law of segregation is a scientific law stating that 1. Organisms inherit two copies of genes, one from each parent. And 2. Organisms can only pass one of their two genes to their children. When you think about it logically, this law makes sense. The father starts with two copies of gene, and the mother also has two copies. If they both gave all their genetic information to their child, it would have four copies total. In most species, this would lead to the death of the offspring, In animals, chances are that child would not even be born. In order to have a healthy child, each parent only passes down half of their DNA, therefore giving the baby the correct amount of genes. Because the meiosis division of genes on separate chromosomes are random, when looking at one specific trait, it's left to chance which one is inherited. Okay, but what do I mean by that? Well, let's look at this family tree of peas. I have a purple dot, which indicates purple petals, and this white dot, which indicates white petals. If the father has two purple petals, and the mother has one of each, it's up to chance what the child will have. First, let's put the father's dots in a bag. And we'll pull one out, and wow, shocker, it's purple! So now we can give that to the baby flower. Now let's see what the mother is going to give the baby. Okay, I pulled out another purple. So this means the baby's genotype is going to be homozygous for purple. But that was totally luck. The baby easily could have been this, if chance had made it that way. This is the important factor of the law of segregation. Okay, so now we're getting into the visual explanation of simple Mendelian genetics. We've established in the definition section that diploid creatures inherit two copies of the same gene. However, the allele types can be different on each of those genes. This leaves the trait being either homozygous or heterozygous. Mendelian genetics is basically a way of explaining how alleles interact with each other. Let's start with this example. There are two purple alleles in this genotype. And look, the flower's phenotype is purple. Now we'll look at this example. There are two white alleles in the genotype. Well, no surprise, the flower's phenotype is white. Now let's look at the final combination. There's one of each allele in the genotype. The flower's phenotype is purple. Wouldn't you think it would be some kind of mix of light purple? Why does the homozygous purple flower look identical to the heterozygous flower? This is the effect of dominant and recessive traits. A dominant allele is an allele that is always visually expressed if present. A recessive allele can be hidden. You'll only see the recessive trait phenotypically if there are no dominant alleles present. So, as visual learners, how can we understand this? Follow this one rule. Dominant allele dots must go on top, and recessive alleles must go on the bottom. Let any extras fall where they may. In the case of the flowers, the very first thing we do is identify which allele is dominant. Looking at the heterozygous flower, we notice the genotype has both purple and white alleles, but the phenotype is showing purple. Do the dot check. Take whatever color is showing and place it on top. Purple is our dominant and white is our recessive. Let's do a quick run through of what that means. If I tell you I'm giving you a flower that is homozygous recessive, homozygous tells you that it's two of the same. Recessive, in this case, tells you it's white. You can instantly grab two white dots. Now, to find the phenotype, we follow our golden rule. Place the recessive allele on the bottom and let the extras fall to the top. What color is showing? White. Now, if I only tell you that the flower I'm giving you is purple, can you figure out the genotype? You know that the allele on top is purple for sure. But do you have any certainty right now what is underneath? No. A purple flower could be this or this. Let's put this mindset to use within classic instruction. Genetics and alleles are used in science to study inheritance. But remember, the law of segregation explains that each parent only passes down one of their two genes. And because these two genes are on different chromosomes, it's up to chance which gene is inseminated and creates the child. If you want to understand more on why this is, feel free to study meiosis, but I'm not going to go into that for this video. A Punnett Square is the most common tool for predicting inheritance. It's used to calculate the odds of an offspring, phenotype, or genotype. Like in the earlier example, both parents have two genes that can go in the bag. For this example, this bag is the father, and this one is the mother. Also, since we're connecting this to classic instruction, we need to add capital and lowercase letters to our alleles. Dominant alleles always use uppercase letters, and recessive alleles use lowercase. Now, if both parents are heterozygous, there are four different combinations for the baby. I could pull out green from the father and green from the mother, making this baby genotypically uppercase GG and phenotypically green. I also could just as easily pull green from the father and yellow from the mother, or similarly, yellow from the father and green from the mother. Those babies would be then genotypically heterozygous uppercase G, lowercase G, and phenotypically green. The final possible combination would be if I randomly pulled yellow from both parents, making the child homozygous little g, and phenotypically yellow. This logic is where the Punnett square is drawn from. It looks at all the possibilities. On the left, we place both of the father's possible alleles to give, and on the top, we place both of the possible alleles the mother could give. These gives us all possible offsprings. And of course, we can check genotype by looking at both alleles, and phenotype by placing any dominant alleles on top. Let's solidify this method by doing some examples. In pea flowers, there's a gene responsible for petal color. Dominant alleles code for the flower to be purple, whereas recessive alleles code for it to be white. A heterozygous purple flower is crossed with a homozygous white flower. Determine the genotype and phenotype ratios of the offspring. First, we write out the dominants. Capital P equals purple, lowercase p equals white. Next, let's look at the terms and figure out what two alleles the parents have. The first flower says heterozygous purple. Remember that heterozygous means different. This tells us they have one dominant and one recessive allele. To double check, we do the phenotype test, and sure enough, the flower would look purple, which matches with this question's description. The next parent is described as homozygous white. Homo means same, which is how we know that there are two white alleles. Quick phenotype check, and we're good to go. Each of these alleles gets placed in the outer boxes as the possible allele to get passed on to the offspring. Then you simply fill out the chart like so. Once filled, you have to complete the question by writing out the answer. Start with the genotype. Two big P little p and two little p. Just like fractions in math, ratios in bio need to be reduced down. The final answer for genotype is one heterozygous and one homozygous recessive. Now we do the phenotype. Place the dominant dots over top and we get two purple and two white. Again, reduce that down to one purple to one white. Okay, now a more complicated question. We're going to use the offspring to determine the parents. In one cross of tomato plants, 148 red and 50 yellow tomato plants were produced. Determine the probable genotype of both the parents. Which allele is dominant? Assume the trait is influenced by only two alleles and follows the law of Mendelian inheritance. Use the letters big R and little r to represent the alleles. We're going to start by dividing 148 by 50 to determine the ratio. This comes out to a 2.96 to 1 ratio. We can round that up to 3. Our 3 to 1 ratio reminds us of our heterozygous square, so we can guess that red is dominant. But because it's a guess, we need to check our work with a Punnett square. Place 1 yellow and 3 red dots in the square. Extrapolate what you know from there. If yellow is recessive, that means it has to have two lowercase r alleles. This line definitely needs to have a yellow allele, and so does this one. If this row has a yellow allele, but the phenotype of the tomato is red, then the parent's second allele must be red and the red allele is dominant. Same logic goes here. Now we finish by answering the question. The genotype of the two parents are both heterozygous. I hope this gave you a good understanding of the fundamentals of Mendelian genetics. Remember to print up the glossary, which can be found in the description, if you think it would be helpful to you. If you'd like to continue, click here. Otherwise, thanks for watching, and I hope this helps. I'd love to hear any feedback from you, as I'll be making more educational videos in the future and want to improve.